GLP, and he will talk about some cute and sexy strikes.
Okay, thank you. Well, thank you for the invitation to speak. So I will, actually this is a quotation from Gromov, so I will explain a little bit later where this comes from, and I will give you the complete quotation. So first, what I want to do is remind you what is a symmetric space, a Riemannian symmetric space. Okay, so what is a symmetric space? So you have a Riemannian manifold, M, with a metric G. And it's a symmetric space if at each point, for each point P in M, there exists a global isometry that we'll call SP, which fixes P and whose tangent map at P is minus the identity. Okay? So SP should fix P and its tangent map is minus the identity. So it's locally it's just a geodesic reflection. Okay, you have a point here, it goes to the symmetric. Okay, so for examples of this are just all spaces of constant curvature are n. Just for the symmetry at a point P, you take the usual symmetry, but you can do the same thing with the sphere, with its round metric, or with the hyperbolic space with the metric of curvature minus one. And you have a classification of symmetric spaces. In what follows, I will be mainly interested in symmetric spaces of non-positive curvature, okay, whose Riemannian curvature is everywhere non-positive. And let me maybe just prove something. Maybe it's the only thing I'll prove in the talk. So let me prove for you that if you have a symmetric space, first thing is that automatically it's just with this definition, it's a complete Riemannian manifold. And why? Because if you have a geodesic, okay, let's say you have a geodesic parametrized by some interval to gamma from I to M, and you want to prove that, let's say I is the maximal domain of definition, it's an interval of R. And I say that automatically I is all of R, and why? Because just you have your geodesic, you can take a point P on the geodesic, and you can take the reflection at P, okay? And it will preserve globally the geodesic because it maps a geodesic to a geodesic. So basically this tells you that the domain of definition of your geodesic, it must be symmetric with respect to all of its points. And the only interval in R which is symmetric with respect to any point is all of R. So for free, you get that it's complete. And then one second thing, that elementary thing I want to explain is that automatically also it's homogeneous. Okay, once you have a complete manifold, it's the theorem of Hopf and Hopf-Reno tells you that whenever you have two points in a complete manifold, you can join them by a geodesic. Okay, so if I take P1 and P2, there's a geodesic arc from P1 to P2. And now I can take the middle of this geodesic, let's call it P, and the geodesic symmetry SP will map P2 to P1. So you have an isometry mapping P2 to P1. So automatically the group of isometries is transitive. And as a group of isometries of a Riemannian manifold, it's a Lie group. So automatically you get that a symmetric space, it's a homogeneous space of a finite dimensional Lie group. Okay? So it's related to the theory of Lie groups, etc. And if you are interested in spaces of non-positive curvature, and let's say that there is no Euclidean factor, whatever that means, G will be a semi-simple Lie group. So from the one example is, you can think of SLNR over SON. So this is, you can think of this as the space of ellipsoids in RN of volume 1. And another example which will be important is that you consider R to the P plus Q. You consider the quadratic form x1 squared etc. plus xp squared minus xp plus 1 squared up to minus xp plus q squared. And the symmetric space associated to this is just OPQ over OP times OQ. And if you want to think of this geometrically, you can think of this as the space of positive definite P planes, P dimensional planes, in R to the P plus Q. Okay, you look at all subspace of dimension P in R to the P plus Q, on which this, the bilinear form associated to this is positive definite. And as a homogeneous space, it's this OPQ over OP times OQ. Okay, so now what I want to talk about is some infinite dimensional generalization, infinite dimensional symmetric spaces, which are generalization of the space OP, OPQ over OP times OQ. Okay? So we'll consider a Hilbert space, H. And I will assume that I've fixed a Hilbert basis of H. Okay, so I have coordinates on my space. Let's say x1, x2. Let's say it's separable, so I have a countable number of coordinates. And now I'll consider the quadratic forms, which I don't know if everybody sees here, which takes a vector x represented by a sequence xi to the number x1 squared plus x2 squared plus xp squared, and then I put minus, okay, minus xp plus 1 squared, etc. up to infinity. Okay, so I put minus the sum of the xi squared from p plus 1 to infinity. Okay, so if the xi, if xi is an L2 sequence, this is well defined. And now, well, I can look at the group of all linear maps of H preserving this quadratic form. Okay, so I will call O P infinity the set of all linear maps from H to H bijective, which preserve this quadratic form. And I'll call this OP infinity. Actually, if you are, so since H is an infinite dimensional space, you could worry about, I don't know, continuity or boundedness of linear operators. So here is an exercise for you. If you take a map like this, which is linear bijective and which preserves a quadratic form like this of finite index, then it's automatically bounded. Okay, so I didn't really include it in the definition, but it follows from this definition. And now, well, there is a, similarly to this, there is a symmetric space associated to this group, which is just, let's call it XP. This is just the space of all p-dimensional subspaces of H on which this restriction of this form is positive definite. Okay? And you can also think of it as a homogeneous space of this group OP infinity. And you can define a Riemannian metric on the space and the corresponding distance, and it's non-positively curved. And you can do many things with it. So one important feature is that it's it has finite trunk. Okay, when you have a symmetric space of non-positive curvature like this, its trunk, it's the maximal dimension of a totally geodesic embedding of RK, of a flat Euclidean subspace. So the rank of SLN over SON is n minus 1. The rank of OPQ over OP times OQ, it's the minimum of P and Q. And the rank of this is P. OK, and so there's a, now I will give you the complete quotation of Gromov. So there's a text of, it's like a book of Gromov called Asymptotic Invariant of Infinite Groups. So it's really, it's like a survey with like hundreds of ideas and things to explore. And he says, I'll first tell you, he says the spaces like this XP looks as cute and sexy to me as the finite dimensional siblings, but they have been for years shamefully neglected by geometers and algebraists alike. So this is the cute and sexy spaces that Gromov suggests to study. And so he suggests to study like discrete subgroup of OP infinity through the action on this. And you have to define what discrete means and to look for examples of interesting group with representation in this OP infinity. Okay, so when P equals 1, for instance, what you get is the infinite dimensional. Real hyperbolic space. Okay, so what I want to do in this talk is some advertising for the following fact. So if you take the group PSL to R, so the you can think of it as the group of orientation preserving isometries of the Poincaré disk. It admits many interesting representations into the groups OP infinity. Okay, so this is what I want to explain. So for each p, each integer p, you can construct a one-parameter family of representation of PSL2R into this group. So the study of when p is equal to 0, it's just O infinity is just the orthogonal group of a Hilbert space. So the study of orthogonal or unitary representation of Lie groups, it's something classical. But what I want to advertise is that this also exists. And I mean, this also works. I'll just talk about PSL2R, but I want to mention that one can also consider, instead of PSL2R, PON1, the isometric group of the n-dimensional hyperbolic space. Okay, so these representations, they were actually well known to representation theorists. They have been known for like 30 years to representation theorists, but they were a bit unknown to geometers. And I kind of, I mean, they appeared in some work I've done with Thomas Delzan and later with Nicolas Monod. And now there's a student here called Arturo who is studying these things also. Okay, so I'll try to explain how to construct representation of PSL2R into this group. Okay, so so we have to do a little bit of representation theory. So we'll consider the Poincaré disk. So PSL2 act on this. And I will consider the boundary of the disk, which is just the circle. And the Hilbert space we'll look at will be L2 of the boundary with respect to, well, if you think of the disk just as the unit disk in C, the measure is just the Lebesgue measure d theta on the circle. And if you want to something more intrinsic, it's just if you look at the stabilizer of the origin, in it's SO2 in PSL2 or PSO2. And the measure I put is just the unique invariant measure on the SO2. And so there is something called, what we'll do is we'll construct a family of representation that I'll call pi s. So s here will be a complex number. And this will be a family of linear representation of PSL2R on this Hilbert space. Okay, so for each s, pi s will be a morphism from PSL2R to the group of, I'll call it GL of L2. It's just a group of bounded linear operator of this Hilbert space. And depending on the values of the parameter C, of the parameter S in C, we'll discuss what are the properties of this representation. So, okay, so what is the linear representation? So I take a function f, this is an L2 function on the circle, and I want to define what is pi s g of f. Okay, g is an element of PSL2R. Okay, so PSL2R acts on the disk and on its boundary, so I'll just let g act by precomposition on the function f, so I consider f composed with g inverse. There is no s so far. So I will multiply by something which depends on S, and so I'll put the Jacobian of G inverse. I'll put an absolute value. Ah, okay, no. G is in PSL2R, so this is positive, I don't care. So the Jacobian is the Jacobian with respect to the measure d theta, okay? SO2 preserves the measure, but not all of PSL2R preserves this measure. And I will put a complex exponent, okay? I'll put S. And if you allow me, I'll put 1/2 plus s just to normalize, because I like to normalize like this. Okay, so I take a function f, I precompose it with g inverse, and I multiply by the Jacobian of g to the power 1/2 plus s. Okay, so this is a positive number, so the complex exponent makes sense. It's just exponential of this times the logarithm of the Jacobian. Okay, so this is a representation. You can check it. It's a homomorphism. And now I will. I'll draw the complex plane. And now I want to discuss what are the properties of this representation depending on where S lives inside the complex plane. So first, one thing which is known is that this representation is always irreducible, except when for a discrete set of parameters. Okay, so irreducible means that there is no non-trivial closed invariant subspace. So the only parameters which for which the representation is reducible are they live on the horizontal axis and they are just numbers of the form 1/2 plus an integer. So you have 1/2, 3/2, minus 1/2, etc. Okay, so pi s is reducible if and only if s is of the form 1/2 plus an integer. Okay, and now a little computation. So I'll write like this with brackets the L2 scalar product on my space of L2 function on the circle. So if I take two functions f1 and f2, and let an element g of PSL2R act on f1 by pi s of g, and I will let g act on f2 by pi minus s bar of g, and I'll compute the scalar product. Okay, so I apply not the same representation to the two functions, pi s of g on one side and pi minus s bar of g on the other side. And if you compute this, so this is an integral, etc., you will have f1, f2 bar composed with g inverse, and you will have some Jacobian. And what happened is that, okay, in the scalar product, this is C-linear in the first variable and anti-C-linear in the second, so you have a conjugacy. So the Jacobian will have a 1 half plus s, plus the exponent which come from the second term, which appear with the conjugacy, because of the scalar product is this. So you see that the s will disappear, and you will just have a Jacobian to the power 1. So you can do change of variable. Okay, so at the end of the day, you do a change of variable, and this is just the integral of f1, f2 bar. And so this is the scalar product of f1 and f2. Okay, so this little computation tells you that pi s and pi minus s bar are dual, or I don't know how you call this. So in particular, for instance, if s is equal to minus s bar, meaning if s is imaginary, well, you get that pi s is unitary. Okay, so on the vertical axis here, you get something unitary. Okay, so now what happens for other values of s? So now I'll just focus on the case where s is real and actually where it's positive. Okay, so we look at this part of the real axis, the positive number. And it turns out that when you look at these values of the parameter, then there exists a bilinear form let's call it by BS on L2, which is invariant under pi S. And this bilinear form, it's quite easy to describe, okay? L2 of the circle, you can think of an L2 function as its Fourier series, so it's a direct sum of a Hilbert direct sum of the line generated by En. Well, let's say En is the function which take e to the I theta to e to the I n theta. And this bilinear form BS, it makes this decomposition orthogonal, and it's just you rescale the scalar product by some constant which depends on S on this line. Okay, so BS makes this decomposition orthogonal. And the norm of En is just some function of n and s. But the thing is that there are parameters where the representation is reducible. And actually, for these parameters, some of these coefficients will vanish. So what happened is that this, the fact that there is this reducible representation, it allows this bilinear form to change signature. So okay, so in the first interval, in the interval 0, 1, half, BS is positive definite. It's not complete, but you can complete. So you have this little interval here. In this little interval, you get a family of unitary representation of PSL2R. It's called the complementary series. It's well known. And actually, when you cross this value of the parameter, so here the bilinear form degenerates. And then here you get something of signature 1 infinity for any S here. So you get a one parameter family of representation of PSL2R into the group O1 infinity. And when you cross this parameter, again the signature changes and you get a representation into the group 2 in, I mean, something of signature 2 infinity, and so on. The index increases of 1. And actually, I can give you the formula here. This is like the, let's say you, we can normalize so that lambda 0 is equal to 1 for all s. And this is the product from 0 to the absolute value of n minus 1 of I plus 1 half minus s over I plus 1 half plus s. I mean, it doesn't really matter the formula, but you see that this, if s is very small, all these things will be positive, and when s grows, it can change sign. So, okay, so for each p, you get a one-parameter family of representation of PSL2R into this group OP infinity. And now to conclude, so when p is greater than 1, there are many interesting open questions about this representation. You can try to study them geometrically, studying the corresponding action of PSL2R on the cute and sexy space that Gromov was talking about. So now let me, if you don't like infinite dimension, let me just mention one corollary of the existence of this representation, which just deals with locally compact spaces. And so here, in this interval, you have for each point in this interval, you have an action of PSL2R on an infinite dimensional hyperbolic space. So just the ball of a Hilbert space with a hyperbolic metric. So you get an action. Pi s gives you an action of PSL2R on the hyperbolic space of infinite dimension. And actually, you can prove that these actions inside H infinity, PSL2R preserve a convex set, closed convex set, which is locally compact. So using this, we proved, this is something we proved with Nicolas Monod, that there exists a one-parameter family, Ct. It says that t lives between 0 and 1, of cat minus 1 spaces, which are locally compact. And with the following properties. For all t, the isometric group of Ct is exactly the same as the isometric group of the hyperbolic plane. It acts co-compactly and minimally on Ct. Minimally means that there is no convex closed invariant subset. Okay, you're in a space of negative curvature, so there is an option of convexity, there is uniqueness of geodesic. And C1 is just H2. And all these spaces are non-isometric and even non-homothetic. I mean, they are not isometric, and they are not even isometric after rescaling the metric. Okay, and these spaces, they appear as invariant convex set in H infinity. So even if you're interested in spaces, metric spaces of non-positive curvature, cat 0, cat minus 1 spaces, this is a corollary about like locally compact spaces that we discovered looking at this infinite dimensional representation. Okay, and I think it's time to stop, more or less.
Sorry, just the tendency of this thing. So what happens to the image of discrete groups of PS and to say, if you restrict PS to discrete groups?
What do you mean, what happens?
Send discrete groups into discrete groups, if so, you have some interesting quotient spaces, or bound spaces.
Well, well, you can. I mean, if you have a lattice or something co-compact, it will act on this thing also co-compactly. It does not answer the question, but it doesn't matter. One thing we did prove is that for a discrete group, I don't know, but if you look at action of PSL2R on H infinity, all of PSL2R, which are continuous in a reasonable sense and irreducible in some sense, we proved with mono that this one parameter family of representation is the only one. You take an action of PSL2R on H infinity, which is irreducible in some sense, then it must be conjugated to one of these.
This is just kind of a vague comment, but I feel there should be a zeta function behind this.
Probably.
Calculation you did of the inner product of S and minus S bar looks like a functional equation, or should correspond to some kind of functional equation of this hypothetical zeta function. And that line where the unitary representations are should be the kind of the dividing line of the half plane where you have convergence and then where you have to extend.
So maybe this is related to what you say. So this bilinear form, I said that it exists for S real positive.
Yes.
But for S complex and with positive real parts, there is also a bilinear form, I think. But I only focused about the real, for real parameters. But there are also stuff going on for S complex with positive real part.
Okay, but what happens when S is the real part is negative? In other words, when the real part is positive, you said you have this, there exists a bilinear form, 1L2, such that, et cetera, such that the representation is invariant. What about when the real part of S is negative?
I'm not sure there is a complete classification of all the bilinear, invariant bilinear forms, et cetera, et cetera.
No? Thank you.